Patrick spoke about schedules.
Yes, so, yeah, that's a presentation about this Shaytune, or actually some bits of what we call, or use it to call Shaytune, and specifically the capacity clamping support. The idea of the presentation is try to understand if we really need such a kind of API and how we can really use it. So I will give a small introduction of what is the problem that we are trying to address with this proposal, and try to describe why it can make sense on some use cases, like, for example, the Android runtime. What is actually the proposal, the concept that we introduce, the alternatives that we evaluated so far, and what are supposedly the strengths of this current proposal. And then I have three or four slides about discussion points, where I've collected the feedback I've received so far from the posting on the mailing list. Yeah, and the idea was to try to get some more clear idea what we should do in regarding this topic. So what is the problem that we are trying to tackle? Is, well, let's assume that we have some kind of runtimes that is available in between applications and the Linux kernel itself. And this is what we can call like an informed entity within our system. So these entities knows quite a lot about what is the role of the different applications that are running right now in the system. So Android is just one of the possible informed entities. We can think about Chrome OS from the laptop background. So where Chrome is this informed entity about what is happening on the different tabs, or maybe also like server service management system like Kubernetes or these kind of things. Even if we never really investigated these things, we just think that maybe the same concept can be scaled also on server scenarios. So these informed entities are context-aware information about what is happening within the systems. And so we can, for example, classify applications. In Android, it's quite common to have a classification where we have what is called the top-up, which is the application which is actually interacting with the users, where we are more interested in giving really good feedback to the user. And there are other background activities. There are other groups, like system tasks and whatever. So in general, it can be useful to consider such a system where the applications are actually managed applications. They are not really free to do whatever they want. They don't necessarily implement a specific programming model or execution model, although this is kind of the case in Android. But in general, there can be a third entity that can assign, let's say, priorities to this application. It can try to partition the resources because we want to give priority to one application or another. Or in general, we want to define different trade-offs between energy saving or performance boosting for certain tasks of an application. And again, in general, these kind of constraints are transient. So it means that maybe at this moment in time, this application has to be performance boosted, but in another moment of time, we want to try to optimize energy for this task, while other tasks, we want to spend more energy to give better performances. So this informed entity is where we can collect this information about which application is important and try to feed this information into the scheduler to support this work on allocating tasks, for example, or selecting operating points for certain tasks. And how this can be performed is kind of a hierarchical approach in which the informed runtime sets some kind of constraints or gives some kind of inputs to the kernel space or hints, trying to bias in, for example, OPP selection or task placements for the different applications and tasks that are active. And maybe it can happen that somehow this informed runtime can monitor what are the resources available actually there and can take other decisions that change the allocation of resources and the constraints that are allocated. So what we focus at mainly is try to bias the existing policies for OPP selections and task placements. What is an example use case? So we did a kind of a tuning exercise on Pixel phones working with Google, and we figured out a set of concepts that seems to be interesting, at least for this specific use case. And these concepts are, for example, the idea that we want to boost some task, whatever it means, boost. So boost means, like, for example, prefer to schedule the tasks, this set of tasks, on more capable CPUs, so CPU with higher capacity, whatever it is, or to run these tasks on faster CPUs. Then we respect what is required. Why? Because, for example, so task pinning is not a viable solution for a boosted application. Because let's say this application is boosted, we want to pin it on a bigger CPU. By why restricting task of a boosted application, all the tasks to certain or on a limited set of CPUs? If these CPUs are already congested or there are other things, it's better to have all the CPUs available. So it's a best effort approach, what we are after, in which we can potentially give a hint, okay, prefer a higher capacity CPU, but if they are not available, still use the energy model and do whatever you want or you can in order to satisfy the goals of these apps. And at the same time, there can be tasks that are reported to be small by PERT. So let's say that you have a 20% task, which is perfectly classified by PERT as a 20% task. If you pick the minimum OPP that can satisfy this task, this task will run, but it will take more time to complete. And maybe for important application and boosted tasks, we still want to consume maybe more energy but and more generate more power, but complete faster these tasks. Run the task on higher OPP with respect to what should be actually chosen by just looking at PERT. Another concept is prefer idle. So there can be certain tasks that are latency sensitive. Okay, so if we can characterize this task and describe them as deadline tasks, go for that. It's quite sure the most sensible solution. If for whatever reason we cannot really describe as deadline tasks these tasks, still we can have a kind of a best effort approach that lives on top of CFS, where we can still try to be energy efficient, but at the same time try to, for example, pick an idle CPU for a CFS task if it is available. While if it's not a preferred idle task, so it's not latency sensitive, we can try to pack it and save energy for these other tasks. And then there were some experiments about negative boosting, what it means. Okay, it's the example before of compilation. So if I want to be really energy efficient, I have to run on a little CPUs. It takes longer, but it's working and I'm really energy efficient. So there can be workloads where we can try to do a controlled degradation of the performances in order to save energy on the long run. Okay, potentially in the ideal world, the runtime measure of the informed entity just shrink the resources, and then the application kind of detect that there are not all these resources available, and it just try to adapt itself, doing the best with whatever applications are available. So overall, there is these three concepts. There is the concept of being energy efficient or to give priority to low latency, and what we identified in Android use cases, at least, that is really a metric. So all these five concepts, they can be combined in many different ways. So what is reported here is classes of tasks in Android where we have top apps that usually the task within this class needs to be boosted and they care about latencies. Or we have background tasks that can be also degraded in performances or at least not boosted, but we want to be energy efficient with these tasks, so try to reduce energy consumptions. So we posted an initial proposal which was building on top of existing frameworks in Singer. Basically, it was kind of working on top of UT Leverage, and this was kind of rejected, but basically the concept I described before are in this column, and we defined or we discussed at LPC an alternative proposal which try to map this concept on things that are more or less already there, or they can be built on top of other controllers, C-group controller, for example. And the idea was, okay, for example, for the boost value, we can try to use the concept of shares. So we are in the domain of CFS tasks, right? So just by playing properly with shares, somehow, which is a concept already there, we can give more CPU bandwidth to certain tasks that we want to give really a chance to complete once they enter the CPU. What the bits that was missing is these two concepts, so OPP biasing and negative boosting, which we are proposing to introduce by extending the CPU C-group controller with two new attributes that are min capacity and max capacity. And this is actually the focus and the scope of the proposal that we have posted so far, and it is in discussion on the mailing list. Additional concepts are more advanced features that we have implemented on a different way on products like Pixel, but the idea is, okay, we can try to remap this concept on top of shares, min, and max capacity, trying to use them in a proper way. So what is min capacity? Basically, the idea is that whenever one of the tasks within a group that has a min capacity attribute defined, whenever it's running, we try to use this specific value to do something to bias OPP selection or a task placement, depending on this specific value. We have more details? No. Okay. Well, I can talk after about that. So which kind of alternative we have considered so far? So the existing APIs, they can fit to the use case. But they seems to be either or overkilling use this API. Like, for example, Task Affinity is already used you can use it to pin tasks, but it seems that we are just moving the problem completely to user space. So it's the user space that decides where tasks have to run. So it can be used, but it's not really something that we want to do. We still want to use the scheduler within the kernel to do most of the things. For example, because we have the energy model in kernel space. Task priorities. This is an example of concept that maybe can be exploited, but is already used to partition the CPU time of runnable task on a CPU. So it's kind of overloading it, in meaning trying to use priority to do other stuff. CPU set and CPU controller are the most interesting solution, seems to be, but they are not feature complete. So they are still missing something really to support biasing of OPP and task placements. So what we worked on is an extension on top of these two things to provide these two features. So the initial solution was posted, and the complaints from the C group's maintainer was that it was not compliant with C group 2, and it's actually true. It was a set of optimization to make the implementation was optimized for the specific use case, but it was not really scaling for the single hierarchy and undefined number of groups. Was not compliant, and also Paul Turner, he suggested that since we are kind of still controlling the resource, which is a CPU, so the bandwidth available from the CPU, we should try to maybe extend the CPU control in such a way that we have a consistent view about the allocation of these resources to different tasks. And that's why basically we come up with the proposal now on discussion. So what are the strengths probably for this proposal? So it's actually a kind of a simple interface that we can expose to these informed runtimes whenever we have this context information that we want to collect and feed to the kernel space. It builds, it just bias existing policies, not introducing anything, is not changing whatever is already there. It's just try to extend on top in such a way that we can use whatever it is. the proposal is the extension. But if the capacity min is higher than the maximum capacity of a little CPU, we can try to bias the scheduler. If there is an opportunity on a big CPU, try to wake up the task on that big CPU, because we want to provide at least this capacity for the task. Maybe that these things can be achieved by just fixing PELT. It's really to be discussed and then evaluated.
I'm not sure that you can fix that on any PELT.
Sorry?
I mean, what you're looking for is just to sort some tasks which don't need to run faster and others that really need to run faster. PELT, you can have the same PELT load, the same load, but works a different behavior. There is no way to make any difference.
Yeah, unless one can decide, okay, we don't want this concept on top of the CPU controller, we want this concept within PELT itself, some kind of property of PELT that can say, okay, PELT can increase faster or more for certain tasks than other. I don't know. I'm just thinking about it. But
after that, how do you consider it?
Yeah, I mean, in my view, at least, I think that maybe it's not really possible to fix everything, and still I think that if we have separate concepts that address specific needs, maybe it's also easier to understand what is doing what.
So the concern is that that if you introduce something like that before addressing the other things, then people will actively use this new feature to work around whatever errors are in there, and they won't see any problems.
True.
That's
why we have to understand if really fixing the error can compensate for this feature
or not. First, address that thing, those things that we know that can be improved, right? And then try to do something on top of them, just to avoid this effect where we have something in user space, then people can use to work around problems they see, like in products, right? Because they have, short cycles or whatnot, and they need workarounds right now.
Yeah.
And then they will use this and then forget about the problem. Right?
Yeah, I think that
that's what basically we are doing. I mean, all the work that Pakistan has been doing, also the stuff that he presented today, just because we want to first fix the known issues and then build on top. I guess what we are trying to do. It's only that threat paralyze work.
What problems? So, okay, go ahead.
No, it's the goal is to have a discussion on top, so it's just free form from now on. The fix for a product release, it's maybe already there, because, for example, in Pixel, we are using something different that provides some benefits on Pixel, the boosting. But this was not considered to be mainline friendly because of many reasons, some of them I've described before. So the goal now is really try to see, first of all, if the concepts are really meaningful to have for failed tasks. Okay, and second, what is the best way to implement them? So really the goal is this one, not to find an hacker that fix some release. I think that, well, Todd is here, can comment, but I mean, Google eventually is interested to switch here if we know that this is going to be mainline, because it has been evaluated to be something that is sensible to have. Otherwise, we can go on with whatever trick we have right now.
Yeah, sorry. For our use case, and what we worked on Pixel was, Android has this knowledge about certain things needing more, needing to be not treated as normal, but be prioritized, because we know it's what the user's looking at, and we need performance for that, and other things which we know are not as important. And so a way for the framework to express this to the kernel, either through this mechanism, or we did the skip tune for Pixel, but some way, for the kernel to be informed by this extra knowledge that user space has about the importance of the app.
Yeah, so minimum capacity is not necessarily a very straightforward way of doing that. Because it doesn't say directly that you prefer performance, you just say that essentially, what you say is that you don't want this task to run slower than X. It doesn't mean that you want it to run faster with respect to other tasks.
That's true. So what we actually have in Pixel is another notion of an explicit boost, and we said we want this to be a boosted task.
Yeah.
So and actually, what you want to say, I think, is that if I have a choice between this and that, then this should be run faster than and by this much respecting the other thing, right? I think
which is
essentially what we have because it was implemented as C groups, and so the one that we want to run slower would be in a different C group that doesn't have
so
boost.
This was the seventh point, by the way. That was okay. We can have an explicit boost value that defines what is the trade-off between energy efficiency or.
You want to use that for both task placement and selection, or
for one of them.
Because of the big versus little thing.
So, however, it's not a single value. Like, for example, to understand if a task is boosted, maybe we don't look only at the capacity mean, but there is also the shares attribute. So, if just thinking loud, but I mean, you can see, okay, if the capacity mean is above a certain threshold, given a certain platform, and looking at the energy model, and this task has a big number of shares, this is probably a task we want to sacrifice energy to go for performances. So it can be more complex, and we are building on top of concepts that are aggregating.
When we start to talk about sacrificing energy versus performance, then you need to stay upfront that this concept doesn't exist in the kernel today.
Yeah.
Because the kernel does, and also with the energy model, as far as I can understand, what it does is to avoid over-provisioning things, because then we just burn energy for nothing. So, but
to complete faster,
if you over-provision, then it is not used. Right?
No, it's used to complete faster a task. I mean, if you have a 20% task and you run it on the first OPP just because it's enough, you will run this task. This task will complete in a certain time. So you can decide that still you want to complete this task as fast as possible.
It is similar to the IO boost we do. Instead of waiting on a disk, we're now waiting on a human.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
Or the human is waiting for us.
I think forever.
Yeah, that's actually a good point. Yeah, it's quite similar. A little bit more tuned because we don't just.
I'm torn between whether or not at what level of extraction we want to provide the interface. We want to say this is a foreground task and then implement all the policy what a foreground task means in the kernel. Or do we want to provide finer grained knobs and then the user space compose the policy? So,
I don't know.
No, I don't know.
But
either.
Still, I think that this could be part of that thing, the minimum capacity number, because it doesn't, as I said, it doesn't tell you about the relationships between different tasks that you made.
Not at all, unless, I mean, if you build it on top, as it is right now, on top of C groups, you can assume that all the tasks within these groups.
No, but this thing by itself. It's like you can arrange for it to mean something to a specific user space instance, right? Like Android. But that in general, it doesn't convey that kind of information. It only tells you that you should not run the capacity. You should reserve this much capacity for.
Not really. It's not reserving. That's deadline and it's granted.
Yeah. So
here
okay,
is the best effort.
Yeah.
Should try to give this capacity.
This is like. I would like to have this much capacity for the task, right? This is more and more precise, but so it probably makes sense with respect to the placement, like the little versus big, because then you can say that if you set the capacity above the little capacity, then you will run on the big one.
Yeah.
Obviously,
we try to place the task
right every time, and then this way you can try to enforce that.
Unless throttle pulls your.
Sure.
Yeah, there is another case which is okay. The capacity can be provided only for this big CPU, but this big CPU is congested in such a way that placing the task there can be co-scheduled, it's preempted, so it's still better to run on a little one, which is idle right now. So there can be, I mean, it's really best effort. It's not really a mandatory allocation or pinning of tasks. There are heuristics that can be built on top of it and try to see what is really the trade-off between performances and energy, in this case, performances.
Just when you mentioned CFS RT period runtime, it's about bandwidth limitation.
So that's a kind of a limitation. I mean, right now with these things, they are not frequency scaled and architecturally scaled, these quantities. So whenever you allocate a period, a runtime over a certain period with the bandwidth controller, you just allocate time independently from the OPP.
Yeah.
So if you have a minimum capacity associated, min cap with a period, then you are kind of granting a certain computational bandwidth. We can avoid min capacity and have maybe frequency scaling here if it never makes sense, I don't know. But it's kind of better if we can frequency scale this one and provide a computational constraints.
But I guess also the other defense that we're using the bandwidth is actually stopping tasks. So you're actually throttling tasks. With the min capacity, you just set the min capacity where the tasks are not throttled.
Yeah.
Use case.
But the point with the capacity min, is it really because it's difficult to make that? Is it a matter of the unit and how to apply that in any? I'm just wondering.
So how do you define the min capacity?
Yeah.
Min?
Is it one of the complaint?
So what we did?
Yes, it is one of the complaints.
That's why
it's a very ill-defined
thing
for the moment.
So one important aspect. Oops, sorry, I went to the wrong page. One important aspect is that if you have this kind of pattern, usually what you find is that these informer runtime not only have knowledge, but they provide quite a lot of services to applications. So the what I'm saying is that the characterization of the minimum value required on a specific platform is something that, not completely, but for certain kind of activities, it can be really profiled at that level, which is platform integration level. It's completely independent from the application. Mm-hmm. I know that the rendering pipeline has these behavior. Rendering pipeline maybe we became deadline. Okay, but there can be some other kind of workload that is provided by this layer, and it can be optimized by the platform integrator while profiling. And this benefits available to all the apps freely because they just respect an execution model which is enforced by this guy here. So yeah, but this is not generic enough. Maybe that for one specific application, you have to define a different min capacity because you are profiling the application. And then you have to tell this guy here, okay, when this application is running, this is the min capacity you set for this guy. So it's a matter of tuning your platform. So we are still in the domain of tuning the platform, but at the end, the goal is that there is something in user space that helps the kernel to do the best, using the energy model, using the heuristic, using the OPP selection, giving these kind of inputs, not really constraints, but inputs or hints that it gets from user space.
And can't we use the RT runtime and period value instead of throttling just as a way to set the min frequency? I mean, if we continue say that right now we are not scaling time with the current frequency.
Yes. Yeah. Oh, I mean, not that I know.
Can't we add this a special mode of that in which we scale and we increase the PP? We can use this value. And
so you mean that by the ratio of these two, we figure out the mean capacity?
Yeah. I mean, I don't know from Android point of view, but most of the time, it's all about, I know that I have to run each amount of milliseconds every...
Yeah, the only constraints eventually is that you are really throttled.
You don't want to be throttled. I don't know if being able to disable this throttling...
It's still a best effort approach, and we don't know how much really an application will require. So, and
I think that this process or task is important and it should be run faster if possible.
Yeah.
And it looks like that.
For this specific attribute, yes. Then there are others, the shares and the things
I know, I'm talking about this particular one.
Yeah, that's indeed one of kind of a controversial point in the list.
You want us to run faster. What does that mean? What action do you take?
The same as this, because we don't know what this means.
Okay.
there is already a similar situation with noise level, which is mapped to weight versus preemption. Some people feel that heavy tasks should more readily preempt lighter tasks. But they are independent notions, the weight and therefore the
slice distribution and the latency requirement. So it is for a lot of people already a bit mixed up, and I feel that if we can overload the weight with more special markers, that's just going to be an even bigger mess.
By weight, you mean also shares?
It's the same thing, isn't
yeah.
it?
Yeah, yeah.
So yeah, I don't know.
Well, from a control standpoint, we are not using them, right?
So we need to find some concepts that make sense to expose, but don't limit the implementation too much. Yeah, I don't know.
Also, I think what Vansan was proposing to try to use that the runtime field might still be an overloading of something that we already have, so probably we don't want to do that.
That means you need to set up those numbers and play by the constraints there,
yeah.
and people might not want that either.
Yeah.
I always get a lot of complaints that you need to fill in those numbers, otherwise you can't make groups or not. Because that is not really what you want either. It's
yeah.
just a way to fudge in the system. So one of the things you can do, which I don't like, is say that by the same reasoning that heavy tasks preempt easier, make heavy tasks inflate their perceived utilization by some ratio.
But that was the original proposal.
Yeah, I know, that's an analogous. And I don't like it because that makes us up those things that are already mixed up.
Screw your runtime or whatever user space, some another thing knows that, say, this is a special process, then it really should run faster than anything else because it's like I know, visible to the user at the moment. And that's something that the user is waiting for. But that is unrelated to whether or not it is heavy, right?
Exactly. That's my point. So what concepts do make sense to expose? I don't know.
So this approach is more the fine-grained, the one that you was describing is more fine-grained.
Yeah.
The boost approach is more the single value, everything in one concept. The concern in that case, it was that we are using a single value to boost, for example, the utilization. But in this case, we are affecting a resource, which is CPU availability and bandwidth, which is already controlled by a CPU. So we should try to have a consistent view. And if we have two different handlers for the same things, they can collide, whatever. So let's try to put everything in one place.
Yeah, I agree. But I'm still struggling to make sense of what concepts are natural for this level of abstraction.
Yeah.
You don't want to expose too many implementation details, and you don't want to pull in too much policy. Well, I don't know.
There are other points maybe we can go through, and then eventually we can have. So the other point was related to the semantic, to actually it's kind of related to what we have discussed so far, but basically for both mean and max capacity. So the difference for max capacity is that, for example, we can constrain what is the OPP that is selected for certain tasks. And it can be used for this controlled degraded degradation of performances for certain tasks. And another use is that, for example, right now in the shared util governor, if a real-time task runs, we go to the maximum OPP. Maybe in some, especially mobile use case, it's not really required. You can easily profile whatever real-time task you have, and you see that a certain OPP is just good enough for these tasks. With such a concept, you can easily say, okay, scheduled works exactly right now, but if there is a capacity max attribute defined for these tasks, so these runtime tasks will not go to max, but it will go to these, to the first OPP that is compliant with these capacity max, which is usually one of the available OPPs in your system. If you don't set it by default, it's 1024, so it goes still to max for every real-time tasks. But the problem here in discussion is how we should aggregate these values, so how we restrict them. First of all, how they are inherited. So if you have a task that has a certain attribute, we create other tasks and charts, whatever, what we do, can we just copy the attribute, or how they should be restricted in case of C groups, and we have a hierarchy of C groups, so we have a max capacity defined. The child groups can have only smaller max capacity. This is the current implementation, and regarding capacity mean, the contained group can have only bigger capacity mean. The idea here is that if a group is a set of tasks that we require to be served at a certain OPP, minimum OPP, then all the child within or the following groups from this one, they cannot harm the performances of the overall set, so they can be eventually further boosted from the controller, whatever is Android runtime, but they cannot be probably going down. This is the most controversial bit, because Tijun was saying, okay, we should probably use the reverse for this one and use a constraining interface. Another point, capacity, maybe is not generic enough across different platforms. I don't know, it's normalized now. We have this 1024, which always represent the maximum capacity. So I think it's already kind of normalized across different platforms. So I think this point is not really, yeah, an issue. And the final point, which is kind of related to the previous one, is so right now we are using C group as a primary and actually the unique interface to define these attributes for tasks. There is no other APIs to specify for a single task min max capacity. And Tijun is not really happy about that. It says that these attributes should be there independently from C groups being available or not in the system. So there should be some kind of per task API that allows to set these attributes. The main comment is that capacity is not countable units that can be partitioned among different tasks and groups. So it's more like attribute range description, the kind of controller that we have. And so we should probably use a model similar to what we use for task affinity and CPU set. So you can set a task affinity for a task using an API. If the task is moving within a CPU set, the CPU set override the task affinity. I think it works that way. So the CPU set just mask whatever is the task affinity enforced for the task. And this was the proposal. You know, it can make sense, but it seems to make sense, at least to me. But the main point is, okay, if you don't use Cgroup as a main interface, what we should use? If it makes sense, everything that we discovered so far, we have to identify an API. The only proposal so far is from Joel, the Google guy working with Todd. They was thinking, okay, maybe we can extend peer limit to set these attributes. I don't know, because there are certain attributes like min capacity, which is something that you used to ask more. While I think that in peer limit, usually you can only lower you can set limits, not boosting. You cannot boost for feature, but yeah, I really don't know. It's a recent comment, so it has to be better evaluated. Otherwise, we have to find a more convenient regular API to be used.
So, question: have you considered using a multiplier instead of max?
A multiplier?
Like a
form of
the denominator and denominator, like values, and you multiply like this, and then
divide by that. Mm-hmm.
And you get a qualified value.
For
and
what?
For capacity, say.
Yeah.
And sure. Then you can push it however you want, and you can also negatively boost it by setting it the denominator, and then the
yeah.
is the same.
So
but it's a different mechanism.
Yeah, I see. So it was not implemented that way. In the previous implementation, there was something which was basically a boost value that was used to multiply and scale. Actually, it was implemented the same way, it's multiply and divide to do it faster. The experimental experience that we had is that usually maybe you have to boost up to a certain value because there are really small tasks that you don't want to run to the at the lower OPP. You want to run them faster, and so at least a certain OPP. But once you cross a certain minimum capacity, it doesn't really make sense to boost them more. And actually, you risk to spend more overhead on doing this trick and compute the boosting than what you get.
The reason why it doesn't make sense to boost them more is because then it becomes too expensive in terms of...
No, because it doesn't pay off. At the end, it's a best effort approach. So we want to, for example, ensure that this task has a chance to run on a big CPU. But if a task is really small, then it makes sense to multiply by a certain constant, and we can increase the chance to run on a big CPU. But if it's a task already there or already big, multiplying just because it's there, it doesn't really make sense. So we do overhead without really getting a benefit from it. So it seems that actually what we really need is to define, okay, we have to consider everything which is at least at this level. And if you are already above, it's fine. Because you are already on a big
so
CPU problem.
Do you want to play with boosting utilization instead of...
This was the original proposal.
Instead of boosting, instead of setting capacity limits or something
yeah.
like that.
Yeah, the original proposal was getting the whatever is the utilization signal, you specify a boost value, which is converted into a multiplier and divider, and every time we read the task utilization or CPU utilization, we inflate the signal for
right.
these things. And then the task appear to be bigger, so we pick a bigger CPU or an higher OPP, even if the task is smaller.
Yeah, and that's not worth it sometimes.
This was not considered useful, mainly because it's, I mean, it was affecting the utilization of CPU, and if you want to plug in into the C groups, there is already a controller that has to be used. Maybe
I
it can
see.
Be. Or the other point is, okay, we are working on top of utilization, so yeah, I mean, we are inflating a concept which is already there to do something, and that there is this proportional things that is useful only up to a certain level. Above a certain level, you do math on top of a signal and you don't really have benefits. It can be improved with a slightly better implementation, can just avoid to do the multiplication if you cross a certain threshold, but still you have to define a threshold somehow. And so we probably come back to this approach. However, the yeah, this was the original proposal, and it's where we use this boosting value to inflate the utilization of a task or the run queue utilization. I think I have just just to see how it's working. So, like in this case, is a we have 10% tasks that are kind of background tasks, and one 10% task which is a top-up. And it's configured in a C group where the mean capacity is 80% and the max, well, this doesn't care. Okay, I'm just running on a CPU just to make the example simple. And in this case, we cap the maximum capacity. So whenever these tasks are running alone, we don't want to run higher than 20%. And what happened is that these are the two constraints, max capacity and mean capacity. And depending on the tasks that are at this moment runnable on the run queue, we aggregate the two constraints and the utilization. This is the actual utilization reported by the run queue. And whatever is the utilization reported to scheduler or to the scheduler is something which is within the constraints and it respects the utilization required by the CPU. So we go like that. And let's see if there is a new thread. Yeah. Like here, there is a max cap. So even if we ask more, there are only small tasks running. We don't go higher than this OPP. And then as soon as we have an higher task, we go up and can ramp up the frequency. This is what happened in another CPU, CPU2, CPU1. And they are aggregated by scheduled in the normal way. This is how the frequency are selected, while these tasks are mixing and matching on these two CPUs. This one united with the shares, So in this case, for example, there is a task that is in a group without shares. So both background and top up, they have the same shares. So what happens is that the top up has a lot of preemptions while it's running. While if we increase the shares value, actually we get for the top up when it's running, when you enter the CPU, it has the chance basically to run to completion. So we never have preemption latency. We have only a little bit of wake up latency, but it's way below 1 millisecond. So it's quite good. This task is for scheduled with other 10 tasks in a completely saturated CPU. But still, if this task is important, the scheduler is already able to provide a run to completion for the specific task. Yeah, so these are just some details. I mean, these things are on discussion now on the mailing list. There are comments coming from different people, but I don't know. I think that for us, the goal is try to understand if everything makes sense, and if it makes sense and the implementation is not okay, how we have to change them. And we would like to try to find a response to this question. So if you can contribute on the list to the discussion, is more than welcome. Other questions, comments, tomatoes? No. So we have done.
Little time.
Yeah.